I was just kind of laughing as I came up, because the theme of 1 Peter is victory over suffering, and chapter 5 is about pastors. So I guess victory over suffering sometimes is dealing with your pastor. I'm not sure. Can be. No. The theme this morning is be faithful. Be faithful. And he addresses pastors, elders, but it applies to all of us. A standard for a pastor is a good standard. It's a qualification that God gives that a pastor has to meet. And then as Christians, we can look to that and say, well, that's a good standard that I want to meet. So let's read 1 Peter chapter 5. I'm just going to read the first four verses. The elders which are among you I exhort, who am also an elder, and a witness of the sufferings of Christ, and also a partaker of the glory that shall be revealed. Feed the flock of God which is among you, taking the oversight thereof, not by constraint, but willingly, not for filthy lucre, but of a ready mind. Neither as being lords over God's heritage, but being ensamples to the flock. And when the chief shepherd shall appear, ye shall receive a crown of glory that fadeth not away. We'll just stop reading there. Like I said, he's writing here particularly to elders and pastors, but it applies to us all. And I think you'll find this will be a blessing this morning. The word elder has more than one meaning. I had it applied to me yesterday. I heard a little child as I left say, it was an old man. it means you're older in age, elder. And it also has to do with a position in the church. There's three words that he uses for the same position, pastor, bishop, and elder. And it's a person who is spiritually mature and has a place of leadership in the church. Well, I can say without a doubt, spiritual maturity is the goal for all of us. All right? You know, as Christians, it doesn't just mean, oh, he's an elder, you know, he's got to be that way. Every Christian's goal should be to grow in the Lord. In fact, later on in 2 Peter 3:18, he says, but grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. All of us should have the goal to be faithful and to be mature. Well, to be mature, it doesn't happen overnight. I wasn't born like this, all right? I wasn't born old. I was once a young man and then middle-aged, and middle-aged is just however you look at it. Depends on how long you expect to live, I guess. But to be mature, now that's a goal that requires faithfulness. And that's our topic this morning. It requires us to be faithful if we're going to grow in the Lord. I've several times in my life had people say to me, I would love to know how to play the piano. Well, there's a secret to learning to play the piano. Number one, you have to get a piano. And number two, you have to practice. Pretty much every day, for a long time, a long time. My wife attributes her mother to her being able to play the piano. She would say, if you don't practice, I'm going to spank you. And she was very faithful then. And she learned to play the piano, and she's glad she did. Well, you know, it's like that with life. It's like that with the Bible. You know, you can't just say, oh, I'd love to know the Bible. Well, to know the Bible, you've got to be faithful. Every day, you got to read it and study it and memorize it and think about it and so on. In your home, if you want to have a good home, listen, you've got to be faithful. You got to go to work, whether you feel like it or not. Kids, you got to go to school, whether you feel like it or not. I can guarantee you, the teachers don't always want to be there either, but they're faithful. You know, they come. Some of you will remember Pastor Pollock, who came a while back and taught on the family. Recently, I got something from him, talking about your home being a refuge. And he took the letters from refuge, R-E-F-U-G-E, and he had a statement for each one. The first one was, R is routines are kept. In the home, routines are kept. You know what he's talking about? Being faithful. You know, there's things we do just because it's the right thing to do. And as Christians, we need to know how to be faithful. And while I said this passage is mainly to pastors and elders, it applies to us all. And Peter is, we're going to look first of all at Peter. He says there in verse 1, The elders which are among you, I exhort, who am also an elder. He said, this is something I do too. He was a pastor. And I want to give you three things about Peter. Number one, he had a vital experience with God. That's what he's talking about there in verse 1. Peter had walked with the Lord. He was a witness. In 2 Peter 1:16, he calls himself an eyewitness. They saw what Jesus did. In fact, John says in 1 John chapter 1, he says, that which was from the beginning, which we've heard, which we've seen with our eyes, which we've looked upon and our hands have handled. He said, that which we've seen and heard declare we unto you. These were people who had a vital experience with God. And I can tell you this morning, if you're going to have an influence in other people's lives for Christ, it's going to be because you are living the Christian faith. You've had a vital experience. You've been saved, and you're walking with Him day by day. Now, you'll have ups and downs, and sometimes you'll learn more from the downs than you do from the ups. But you're walking with the Lord. Just be faithful. Peter saw Jesus' sufferings. He talks there in verse 1, witness of the sufferings of Christ. They saw that Jesus was a real person, and yet He was God in the flesh. They saw that Jesus, He had times when people opposed Him. They took Him and they killed Him. And He rose again. They saw His sufferings. But He says, they were also partaker of the glory that shall be revealed. They saw the glory of Jesus. They saw Him walk on the water. They thought it was a ghost. they saw Him heal people. People rise from the dead. That must have been incredible. They were eyewitnesses of His glory. They were on the Mount of Transfiguration, some of them, Peter was, when Jesus was changed and transfigured before them. They saw His sufferings, they saw His glory, they had a vital experience with the Lord. I want to encourage you this morning, you need to know the Lord. There's a verse in, I can't think where it is, but he says, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. Now he's not saying work for your salvation. He's saying if you're saved, work it to its logical conclusion, to be like Jesus. Be faithful. Number one, have a vital experience with God. Peter did. Secondly, Peter had a loving concern for God's sheep. In verses 2 and 3, he talks to the elders, and these are things that were concerns for him. Feed the flock of God. Listen, he wasn't a pastor because somebody made him do it. He was a pastor because that was God's call on his life. When it says they're taking the oversight not by constraint, he's not talking about his relationship to the sheep. He's talking about his relationship as the shepherd. You don't want to be a shepherd because somebody made you do it. You need to do it because God called you and you want to serve the Lord. Secondly, he wasn't a pastor for the money. There's wisdom in that. You don't want to get into the ministry for the money. And he wasn't a pastor for the power. There in verse 2, he says, not for filthy lucre. Isn't that a funny way to describe money? And verse 3, not as being lords. He served for the glory of God. In 1 Peter 5:11, it says, to Him be glory and dominion forever and ever. That was Peter's attitude. He had a love and concern for God's people. And listen, we need to have that same thing. He did it for love of the brethren. Over and over, he uses the term beloved. In 1 Peter 4, verse 12, for instance, beloved. Think it not strange. Back in chapter 2, verse 11, he said to them, dearly beloved, I beseech you. Second Peter, in chapter 3, four or five times, he calls them beloved. That's why he was in the ministry, because he loved the Lord and he loved God's people. God had called him to that ministry. He had a vital experience. He had a loving concern. And then thirdly, Peter had a desire to please Christ alone. You can see, these are real lessons we can learn, aren't they? Verse 4, when the chief shepherd shall appear, ye shall receive a crown of glory that fadeth not away. He wanted the glory of God. He wanted God to be able to say, well done, good and faithful servant. That was his concern. He had a desire to please Christ. Back in chapter 4, verse 13, he said, rejoice inasmuch as ye are partakers of Christ's sufferings, that when His glory shall be revealed, ye may be glad also with exceeding joy. If you be reproached for the name of Christ, happy are ye, for the Spirit of glory and of God resteth upon you. That was his heart's desire. He didn't care if it was by life or by death, like Paul said. He didn't care if it was by suffering or by good things, you know, by blessing. He just wanted the glory of the Lord. He had a desire to please Christ. Well, that's Peter. He's talking to other elders as well. Let's look at your pastor. When I go door knocking, if I get a chance to talk to people, and you know, I give an invite, and I say, you need to come to our church. It says it's a great, great church, good people. And then I usually say, kind of a strange pastor, though. Now, hopefully they know that I'm the pastor and that I'm joking. They'll look at the picture, oh, yeah, it's you, you know, kind of thing. You have a pastor. Someday you'll probably have a different pastor. I know I'm going to live somewhere for eternity, but it probably won't be in Stafford. All right? Your pastor has a ministry. In verse 2 and 3, it's basically to feed, lead, and protect. That's what a pastor does. He talks about being a shepherd there in, feed the flock. A pastor is a shepherd. A shepherd has to feed the flock. He says that a pastor is to take the oversight there in verse 2. The Bible uses the title for a pastor of bishop. I like that title. You're welcome to call me bishop if you want, you know. People call me pastor. I think it has a real ring. Bishop Bill Bramlett of Brisbane. Sounds good, doesn't it? I get cards printed up. Bishop. And it has to do with the leadership. A pastor is to be a leader. We believe in leadership. Back in chapter 2, verse 25, the last part of the verse, he talks about, you're now returned unto the shepherd and bishop of your souls. That's Jesus. A pastor is to be like Jesus. We all are. Jesus saw that sheep need a shepherd. Do you remember back in Matthew when Jesus was just looking at the people? Here's what it says. He saw the multitudes and he was moved with compassion on them because they fainted and were scattered abroad as sheep having no shepherd. Jesus saw people need a shepherd. Sheep need a shepherd. I don't know if you know much about sheep, but when God calls us sheep, it's not really very complimentary. Sheep are pretty dumb. Sheep are a pretty good proof against evolution, by the way. Sheep can't really exist without a shepherd. I don't know if you know that. The first two guys, you know, Cain and Abel, one of them was a farmer, the other one was a shepherd. He was looking after the sheep. Sheep can't find their way home. If you drop your dog off a couple miles, a couple kilometers from home, he'll find his way home, whether you want him to or not. Not a sheep. He's lost. A sheep can actually become stuck on its back. It's incredible. It's called cast. I was with a farmer friend one time, and here's this sheep laying there, just laying there. And he kind of wiggles it around, gets it going, and he had to kind of do a few little things to it, and then it kind of staggered off, you know. And they'll die. They'll just lay there till they die because they can't get up. It's called cast. They can't find water. Most animals can kind of sniff, and they'll not a sheep. They have to have a shepherd. They'll eat a field until it's dirt, and then they'll eat the dirt. They're just not very smart. That's why they have to have a shepherd to lead them to another pasture. They'll eat anything. So a shepherd has to check the field, make sure there's nothing. Anyway, I could go on and on. That's what I'm saying. When God says we're sheep, it's not very complimentary, but he says sheep need a shepherd. Now, our main shepherd is the Lord. But God has called different ones to pastor, to be elders, to be bishops. Sheep need a shepherd. Jesus is the chief shepherd. He uses that term there in verse 4, when the chief shepherd shall appear. Aren't you glad that we have a chief shepherd? He's also called the good shepherd and the great shepherd. Earlier, let me just read you Hebrews 13, verse 20. He says, now the God of peace that brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect in every good work to do his will. That's a great verse about the great shepherd, the great shepherd of the sheep. That's our Lord Jesus Christ. What I'm saying here is a pastor has a ministry. and it's to the sheep. A pastor also should have the right motive. In 1 Peter 5, verse 2, it talks about some of the motives there. He says, he shouldn't be a pastor because of someone made him to be a pastor. You used to hear, I think it was most in England, where if you had sons, I can't remember the order, you know, one would go into the military and one would go into the clergy and one would go into business. And, you know, it was kind of a set order where your sons would go. Okay, I'm the second son. I guess I've got to be a pastor. No, that's not the way it works. We used to, in Bible college, they used to mockingly talk about pastors who were mama called and papa sent. Listen, that's not the way it works. God has to call us. It has to be willing, and it includes the area, their motive. They shouldn't be lazy. The pastor shouldn't be a lazy person. And let me say, we've got a lot of young men here. We need young men who will hear and heed the call of God for the ministry.
Amen.
Yeah, one time that was me. When we came to Australia, I was 26 years old. Man, that's been a while. I'm losing my tread now. You know, we need a retread. But we need young men who will say, God, I don't know that I can do it, but I'm willing to try. Listen, even Peter, no one is good enough for the ministry. Let me tell you, if you feel like you're good enough for the ministry, you're probably not going to make it. It takes a humble attitude. It takes a person who's going to rely on the Lord. You need to be God called. We need folks who'll hear the call of God and say, Lord, by your grace, I'll do that. And then he talks about the motive of not doing it for money. You know, most men who pastor do it as a financial sacrifice. Now, I know there's a few churches that are big and they can pay the big bucks and all that. But most pastors in the world are what they call bivocational. They have one job where they get money and they have the other job that takes up all their time, and that's the ministry. It's not something you want to go into for money. It's not something you want to go into just to tell people what to do. Verse 3, he says there, neither is being lords over God's heritage. I got an email this week about a group, and I won't spend time on it, but basically it's an independent Baptist group that's a cult. And boy, everything, the pastor is after you about everything. And if you don't do it, man, you lose your salvation. That's not the way it's supposed to work. A pastor is not a lord. He's an ensample. He's an example. The ministry has, a pastor has a ministry. He has a motive. Verse 3, he's to have certain manners as well. He says, neither is being lords over God's heritage, but being ensamples. That word ensample means example. Hebrews 13, verse 7, he says, remember them which have the rule over you, who've spoken unto you the word of God, whose faith follow, considering the end of their conversation, the end of their manner of life. A pastor is to have a good example. I came across a description, or maybe a definition of the word ensample. I really liked it. It's a print left as an impression after a blow has been struck. I just kind of spoke to my heart. You know, it's when you've left a blow, it leaves your fish print there. That's not the ministry. But 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 1, Paul talked about his example as a pastor. 1 Corinthians 11, verse 1. If I can find it here. This is an interesting statement. Paul speaking, inspiration of the Holy Spirit. Be followers of me, even as I also am of Christ. You know, a pastor should be able to say that. Let me extend that further. If someone couldn't be like you and be like Christ, why not? You see, our example should be to be like Christ, shouldn't it? Especially a pastor, but every Christian. Your pastor should have a good example. We need to be faithful. And the Bible then talks about the pastor's reward in verse 4. When the chief shepherd shall appear, you shall receive a crown of glory that fadeth not away. And what a blessing it is to know that what we do for the Lord. You know, your pastor does, you should do the same. You know, I wish I were a better pastor in that I would compliment people on things that they do. I'm often aware and I'm always grateful, but I don't always say it. And we should, shouldn't we? But, you know, we don't do it for my reward. We do it for the Lord's reward. That doesn't mean we shouldn't compliment and encourage each other. But, you know, the Bible says that God is going to give us crowns as we're faithful. There's the soul winner's crown. You know, there's the crown. Let's see, what's it called? Blessed is the man that endureth temptation, for when he's tried, he will receive the crown of life. The crown of life for not giving in to temptation. The crown of righteousness, the incorruptible crown he talks about, just being faithful, doing what God has called us to do. There's a reward. Now, I mentioned Hebrews 13:7. Hebrews 13:17, he says, "Obey them that have the rule over you and submit yourselves, for they watch for your souls as they that must give account." See, I'm going to give an account for my church, for you. That they may do it with joy and not with grief. And then he says, for that is not profitable for you. It's not profitable for you, for your pastor to get in trouble for what you've done. All right? We need to be faithful. It's important for us to know God's standard for a pastor. He goes into it more in Timothy and Titus and so on. And you might say, well, you're the pastor. How does this apply to me? Well, it applies to you. One, in that someday, as a church, we're going to have to call another pastor, a different pastor. And we need to know what God says. But as well, it applies in living a godly standard. This is just a good and godly standard that we're looking at. And if we're going to grow in the Lord, we need to be faithful. You need to be faithful. Don't just say, oh, I wish I knew the Bible. Be faithful and start reading it and memorizing it and learning it. You know, like Peter, let me put this another way. God wants you to be faithful like Peter was. You know, Peter was a faithful, godly man. He had a vital experience with Christ. He had a loving concern for God's sheep. He had a desire to please Christ. Listen, you need that. I need that. You need to have a vital experience with Christ. There needs to be an understanding that you're saved. You need to know Christ as your Savior. And then day by day, you need to be hearing from the Lord. You need to be seeing what God is doing in your life and through your life. Are you saved? Are you walking with the Lord? Man, it's important. If you're going to have an influence on others for Christ, it's going to be because you have something going on. Listen, when there's something going on in your life, people get interested. Peter had a vital experience with Christ. You need that same thing. You need to have a loving concern for God's sheep. You need to care about others. God says they'll know we're Christians by our love. Man, at least know their name and pray for them. You know, get to know folks. There's some lovely folks here. I know all of you, and I meet all of you, but I know some of you don't know each other. And don't run off after the service. You know, seek someone out. Write down their name. Memorize it. Pray for them. Invite them over. Help them. You know, we need to be people who care about others. You need to be faithful to your church and to your pastor so that he can lead you and feed you and protect you. That's his job. He needs to be able to do his job. Have a loving concern for God's sheep. And thirdly, have a desire to please Christ alone. You probably know the verse, 1 Corinthians 10:31. Whether therefore you eat or drink or whatsoever you do, do all to the glory of God. Listen, that needs to be our attitude. With our church, with our walk with the Lord, with our family, with our work, do it for the glory of God. Have a desire to please Christ. Listen, you have every right to expect your pastor to be faithful. It's true, isn't it? I mean, you'd be shocked if you saw me swearing and carrying on or having a fist fight with somebody or, you know, 100 things you could mention. You'd say, oh, that's he's a pastor. He shouldn't do that. Well, let me tell you, God expects you to be faithful too. What's the old saying? What's good for the goose is good for the gander. I'm not sure if that's appropriate, but anyway. It's the same for all of us. You know, the ground is level at the foot of the cross. It's not just one standard for one person and a different one for another. We need to be faithful. God, help us to be faithful. And you know, like a pastor, God wants you to have a ministry. Obviously, a pastor has a ministry. You may not be the pastor, but you have a part. Many churches, and our church is no exception, have the motto, every member a minister. We're called a body, and in my body, every part has a function. And there's nothing I want to get rid of. And as Christians, we need to be a functional, faithful part of our church. In Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 12, he says, he's talking about the church, and he says, it's for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ. That's us. We need to be faithful. We need to have a ministry. Our motivation needs to be right. You know, you shouldn't come to church just to have your needs met. You should also come to church to meet other people's needs, to see how God will use you. Now, hopefully our needs will be met. But let me tell you, there's a couple of ways you can respond if your needs aren't being met. You can say, oh, I'm out of here. I'm going somewhere where they'll meet my needs. Or you can start meeting other people's needs and see if God is actually true when he says, do unto others as you'd have them do unto you. As a man soweth, so shall he also reap. If you're not having your needs met, start looking for that need in others and meet it in them. And I'll guarantee you, God will help you. We need to have the right motive, humbly serving, not selfish, but serving. And then our manner of serving needs to be right. You know, we're not lords over each other. It's real easy to condemn others. But the main one we need to be concerned about is ourselves, isn't it? And if God gives you a ministry, listen, it's not a burden, it's a blessing. Man, it's an honor to get to serve the Lord. Sometimes people think, oh, you know, I've got to do this, got to do that. No, you get to do it. What a blessing. And your reward will come from God himself. Isn't that wonderful to know? God knows our heart. God knows why we're doing what we do. We talked in Sunday school this morning, adult Sunday school class, about the heart of the matter. And it's so important. It's not just the law of the thing, it's the heart of the thing. It's your heart as you serve the Lord. Your reward will come from God himself. Let me encourage you this morning. I found it encouraging as I studied this week. Be faithful. Just be faithful to the Lord. Do what you can. Do it faithfully. You know, it starts with, are you saved? Look at verses 6 and 7 of chapter 5 there. He says, humble yourselves therefore under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time, casting all your care upon him, for he careth for you. Now, that's not exactly about salvation, but that's the attitude that you have to be saved. You have to humble yourself before God. You have to realize that you're a sinner that deserves to go to hell. Listen, no one can be good enough to go to heaven. We don't earn it by works of righteousness. For by grace are you saved through faith. Humble yourself under the mighty hand of God. You know, really, we're just poor sinners crying out, God, save me. And believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, as he said, that Christ died for your sins, that he was buried, that he rose again for your sins. And that without it, you cannot get to heaven. The Bible says Jesus is the only way. Have a vital experience with God. Are you saved? And then, if you're saved, are you faithful? I used to carry in my wallet a little card. It just had these two words, don't quit. Now, I don't feel like quitting a lot. It's not a problem or anything, but sometimes I do. And so do you. Listen, if you're doing right, don't quit. Don't quit. Just be faithful. Just do it one more day. And then the next day, do it one more day. You know, that's the way life is. You only get one day at a time anyway, so you might as well do it that way. Be faithful. Make sure you're saved. Trust Christ. Have that vital experience with the Lord. And then keep having it every day. Be faithful. Like I said, we expect our pastor to be faithful. Well, let's set the example for your pastor. Help him out in that way. It'll be a blessing. Now, this morning, we're going to end with a song, Is Your All on the Altar? It's page 156 in your songbook there and be on the screen. We've sung some great songs this morning, and you know God is going to hold us responsible for what we've sung and said. And this morning, he asked the question, is your all on the altar? Are you willing to be faithful with everything that God has given to you? You know, your time, your family, your talents. All of those things, that they all come from God. Will you be faithful?